Good evening, and welcome to Mechanics of the Fourth Wall. Joining myself and Antonio Subirats from a spaceship somewhere over Stonehenge, England, we have a rendering of the humanoid known only as Mark Sargent. How you doing, Mark?
I'm doing well. How about you?
Yeah, not too bad at all. And how are you doing, Antonio?
I'm doing really well, thank you. How are you two?
Not too bad. Not too bad at all. In case you haven't gathered from the title, Rendering the Plane, we will be talking about simulation theory. And Mark is obviously the best man for this topic by far. So maybe, Mark, you can start off for any of the uninitiated audience members who don't actually know what we mean when we say the words simulation theory, what that actually means.
Oh, where do you start with something like that? I suppose I could take the cheating way out and say that simulation theory would most aptly be described as, was done in movies like The Matrix in 1999, The 13th Floor in 1998, and the predecessor to The 13th Floor, which was World on a Wire, which was a German film, done in the 1970s, I believe, 1975. As a matter of fact, which was, most people think The 13th Floor was an original movie, but it wasn't. It was actually a remake of World on a Wire, which is, are we living in some sort of, and we can only really explain this now, are we living in some sort of simulation that was built by somebody else? We all know that when we drill down to, beyond the cells, we can get to molecules, and then what are the molecules made up? Or if we're made up of energy, which we are, then was that energy manipulated to the point where reality is what was programmed into us? Not to get too philosophical, but the holographic universe, and are we living in a simulation? You try to describe it to somebody 40 years ago, you can't even do it. We can only really get a handle on it now because we've been doing it for a while. The game theory, the guy that I interviewed, which I'll talk about a little bit later, recently. We've only been really digging into the game theory stuff for the last 15 years. And we can build simulations. If you saw that video I just put out recently, how to fake the world with animation, that was done 6 years ago. And that was about as convincing a world as I've ever seen, in real time, where you could go all the way down to the terrain. And when you pulled out, you could intersplice it with stuff that NASA has released, and it's more convincing than NASA.
We're talking much more fundamental than things like I know you often describe things like these stars as being a planetarium projection. But yeah. We're talking at a much more fundamental level, aren't we, when we talk about literally everything being rendered as opposed to just some of our world being projected for the sake of argument.
Yeah. It's the old saying, which is, again, you know this if you... Anyone out there that's played any games at all is going to know this. I mean, it doesn't have to be state-of-the-art games. Anyone that's played games over the last decade is going to know the old saying, which is, we've been asked this when we were kids, which was, if a tree falls in the forest and no one's there to hear it, does it make a sound? And only now do we know the answer to that question. It is, well, probably not, because the tree was never there to begin with. It's it was never rendered yet to save resources. The double slit experiment, and I won't go into that too much right this second, but the double slit experiment, which I think is the creepiest thing in physics, and I think it's the closest thing to magic we have out there, and physicists just think, oh yeah, it's fine, no, it's no problem, double slit experiment, that's not strange at all. The fact that matter doesn't actually materialize, become cohesive unless somebody's watching it, that's just creepy. And they have no problem with that. It's like, oh yeah, it's a wave, it's a particle, it's both. That's no big deal. It's, what are you talking about? That means if you close the door in a room, that room may not actually exist. Depending on where who you are. If there's nobody in there to realize it, to observe it, then it's not there. So yeah, that's what we're talking about here. Simulation and matter. That we're living in. The ultimate version of a holodeck. The ultimate version, I mean, it's not just a planetarium. Yeah, of course, the planetarium comes into effect, but even more, because when I say it's a planetarium, the image, when you're looking at Jupiter up on the screen, yeah, it's Jupiter floating, supposedly floating there. But at a more granular level, it's not even a simulation of Jupiter. It's just a simulation that you were programmed to visualize. How's that?
This, I mean... Sorry, Nathan. So, you know, when you were talking about the various different films, there's a slightly different retelling, but it's a very similar thing, which was Dark City.
Yes.
Yeah. And I love Philip K. Dick. I think the guy was a complete genius. And he wrote Surrogates. Well, he wrote a story which became Surrogates, the film Surrogates with Bruce Willis. And in Surrogates, have you seen it?
Surrogates, what year was it?
I don't know.
That's okay. I'll look it up real fast while you're talking.
Yeah, so Surrogates, if for anybody who's not seen the film, I'm going to completely ruin it now. So you have these characters who are engaged in a story, and halfway through the film, it brings you to the equivalent to The Matrix, where you see Neo in the pod, okay? But instead of being pods and instead of being electrical batteries, these beings, they're human beings who have a dedicated room, as it were, like a wardrobe or a cupboard, where they have everything they need, and they're immersed in a world where they play an avatar. So yeah. In the real world, they're really pasty, you know. They come out from time to time. There might be a delivery they have to take, you know. So the world suspense, the game that they're in is paused, and you know, there's somebody at the door. They have to deal with something. And then they go back into the simulation. So I think as a way of expressing an idea, Philip K. Dick was doing a really good job of expressing the idea of the future having a simulation theory.
Yeah. And you're right. I remember this movie, Surrogates. I misunderstood your pronunciation of it. 2009, Bruce Willis. Absolutely brilliant movie, and you're absolutely right. We've been working towards that. The real retail industry and the electronics industry has been working towards this ideal for a while now. It is the ultimate goal, and that is if you can get people to where they can plug in and don't have to do anything. They just have to do is eat and drink and sometimes sleep, then and then plug into whatever it is. In Surrogates, it was, you know, they're plugging into an alternate version of their a robot, which is walking around, which is a physical robot, but it might as well be the Matrix because it still isn't real. They still are plugged in very, very similar to the Matrix. And the thought is once that happens, then the lines get blurred, kind of like the 13th Floor, where the 13th Floor movie was a simulation within a simulation. You know, that we got to the point where we were creating a virtual world, and it was when they created that virtual world that allowed them to figure out that they were in a virtual world themselves. And that's where we're kind of, that's what we've been kind of moving towards now. I just don't know if whoever built this place is going to allow that to happen because it really confuses things. It's kind of like, you know, if we built the ultimate, kind of like if we built the ultimate planetarium or a holodeck, once you build the first... The holodeck, and I'm not knocking Star Trek Next Generation. I think it was a great series and everything, but the holodeck thing was used as a crutch too many times in that show because it was way open-ended what you could do with that thing to the point where, you know, you had Professor Moriarty and that whole plot line. I know the writers had to work with something. But once you create the holodeck, they're kidding themselves. I mean, that's all anyone would do. That holodeck would be booked solid, nonstop. You're telling me, you know, the people that are on this starship, there would be a waiting line to get into the holodeck, and all the time it was like, oh, yeah, people just schedule. Oh, I think I'll use the holodeck for a while. There's nobody using it. Talking about, that's all anyone would care about because they could create their own, you know, their own reality, and that's what we're gunning for. That's what we've always wanted, to play God.
Star Trek, Next Generation, they have the Q, don't they? Mm-hmm. And the Q, in a kind of round, they're very vague, you know, because they're so superior that they don't have to bother going into the details of explaining their existence and their role in existence. But it's pretty much, they are the guys that run the show. So that could be the way I see them is a little bit like the Dungeon Master in Dungeons and Dragons. Yeah. The guy who can intercede at any point, change the rules, change whatever. So the thing that brings me, that has gives me the biggest question in my mind is, okay, so if this is a simulation, it's non-real, non-physical. It has the illusion, or it has all the qualities necessary to render physicality and the impression of physicality for entities to engage with, those entities being a level of existence in terms of consciousness, but in an ineffable consciousness, only an experiential thing that has no real form and can only find form through the rendered game. So my biggest question is, at some point, there must be physicality, as in the database on which the binary data is input to cause the rendering. Sure. And I think, okay, at what point is that? What kind of reality is that reality? The reality where there's some ultra-cool, high-tech, water-based database that's programmable.
You're basically asking, possible. Where's the hard drive? Is that what you're kind of saying?
Yeah, well, it's not just where's the hard drive. It's like, okay, what can be done with hard drives now? They're looking into crystals. Eventually, they'll be looking into water. That's what they'll be using. It's everywhere. It's programmable. It has memory. It can be altered. And so you have, at some point, there's a database. That's one question. And then at another point is, what being is accessing or creating or modifying the program? Yeah. What being is that? And is that the situation where we have a fractal universe, where if you could look up, you know, if you...
Yeah.
The way questions kind of thing.
Yeah. Then you're getting into the... and I try not to dig, you know, I try not to get into the Russian stacking doll argument too much, because then it turns into the end of the first Men in Black movie, where we become, the entire galaxy becomes a marble in some giant alien's, you know, marble bag. But yeah.
Or a locker. We're just behind some locker door.
Yeah. Forget about time being infinitely compressible and matter being infinitely compressible. Let's talk about what we know. Because I get this question a lot. I get this question every single week, and I'm really kind of surprised that people ask that. That some people that jump to that question, because most people say, you know, what's the dome made out of, and what are meteorites, and what are this other stuff. But there's some people that cut straight to the chase, and they say, hey, who built this place? Where and how did they build it? And I like, you know, there's only two ways you could go with it, which is, it was either built by an advanced race that was, the saying that I love so much. Either God built it or God subcontracted it out. It can only be one of those two things. And whether you're talking about a super advanced race that flies around in a giant golden spaceship and doesn't even have to really fly, it just teleports places, or, you know, a big white overweight guy in a bathrobe with a big beard, take your pick. I mean, really, it's just how you define, you know, a higher power. You know, if a big, which is why I've kind of been hinting at what, you know, what happens next with this thing. If a big golden spaceship all of a sudden landed somewhere in Canada and planted itself there, what? And they came out and they said, "Oh yeah, we built the place." Who's going to say they didn't? You know, all they have to, you know, signs and wonders. It's like, okay, we're going to make the moon green for the next hour. And all of a sudden, the moon's green for the next hour. There's 75% of your population right there. It's going to go for that trick.
Well, Let's get real. If a UFO was going to land, chances of it being in Canada are pretty small. Everybody knows it would be London, of course.
or the Vatican. I mean,
the Vatican. And then Jesus would step out and demand his money. Yes.
Polarization Nation did a little video today that was showing some of the technology actually projecting Jesus. I think it was in South Africa. Now, obviously, it's on a very crummy video phone, so it doesn't exactly look great. But you get the kind of idea of things that they could definitely hoax us with. We're going slightly off topic, so I'm going to bring it straight back to simulation theory, which is to say, first time I read about this, I can't remember, I'm sure it's called Moore's Law, about the computer power doubling every 2 years and becoming half the price or something along those lines. And the New Scientist associated this to simulation theory by extrapolating that out and saying, we're already in a simulation theory by virtue of Moore's Law. In other words, computer technology will have, in the past, gone way beyond we see what we see on our, you know, common garden PC, and that technology, which is, you know, you said you didn't like the Russian dolls example, but that would mean exactly that. The computer that's behind me is literally creating a simulation within another simulation. So if it was the case that they turned the moon green, it's very easily, if we're all simulated, to make us all just know it was green. We wouldn't know it wasn't green yesterday if they changed it to blue today, or whatever color it is. I don't actually know.
Yeah. And by the way, I don't hate the Russian stacking doll argument. It just makes people, you remember, because I try to build my stuff for the lowest common denominator, and the stacking doll argument tends to confuse people, because then you're talking about, okay, which layer are we talking about? I mean, there's some people that talk about, you know, the seven layers of harmonics and all, you know, that there's different dimensions laying on top of each other, which is fine. I totally get that, but you can't go too far into that discussion, because then you start losing track of what dimension you're talking about. The thing I got into discussion with some guy today, claimed he was a scientist, who I was trying to explain, you know, because he was saying, what is it, you know, do you think that there's other dimensions stacked on top of this, other simulations stacked on top of it? And I'm going, well, the argument that, you know, right now, as we're sitting here, there's country music playing all around us, but we can't hear it because we don't have the receiver in front of us. You know, there's all sorts of music flying through the air right now. There's all sorts of television stations flying through the air right now. Who's to say that there aren't other simulations and dimensions stacked literally within the empty spaces of ours right now? What was that movie with George Clooney, who I love so much, Tomorrowland, where there was another dimension literally stacked side by side with the dimension that we were living in right now. I know not a lot of people saw it, but it's not half bad, at least from that standpoint.
Although it wasn't a comparison to simulation theory, there was another one recently with Leonardo DiCaprio. Now, they were using it with dreams within dreams.
Oh, yeah, yeah, Inception.
Inception
was a brilliant... I mean, that was that director's opus. I can't remember his name off the top of my head. But it was brilliant because it was... Yeah, you could have, at that point, you're talking about the 13th floor to the nth degree, practically a simulation within a simulation within a simulation going all the way down, at which you really start losing track of where you are, which is, again, why I try to, at least for simplicity's sake, stick with where we are right now, one world at a time. You know, if there is something outside of here, what I'd like to say, and this is to you, Antonio, is... because you're wondering where the hard drive is and where, you know, is there cool stuff outside of here? Kind of like the 1888 Flammarion wood carving, whatever it is, which shows the monk looking outside, and whatever's out there is completely different to what we are now. I mean, and it seems like it's macros within macros. It's very, very different and very, very organized and very, very cool. I still believe to this day that what is outside of here is the unlimited version of this. You know, art imitates life and life imitates life. This world, and again, I'm going to steal from The Matrix because I love Mr. Smith's rant so much, where he said, did you know, some believe that we lacked your programming language to describe your perfect world, but I believe that human beings define their reality through misery and suffering, which is why The Matrix was redesigned to this. And I quote a Joe Welsh song, a guy used to be in the Eagles a long time ago, a song that he had called Life's Been Good, where it was describing the life of a rock star. The chorus was, I can't complain, but sometimes I still do, meaning it doesn't matter how, look at the reality that we're in right now, or whatever we perceive as reality. It doesn't matter how rich, how powerful, how beautiful, how talented. Everyone's got something to complain about. You cannot escape conflict in this world. It doesn't matter. Even if you had all those things, if you were a rock star slash athlete slash artist slash, you know, all these fun things, you'd still have to deal with mortality. You still have to deal with health issues or something that has to do with your family or anything that's going on around you. There's all these different things. And I'm saying that in a world that is so full of conflict, that is so perfectly conflicted, that may, you know, for me, the outside of here has to be the opposite. It has to be the unlimited version of this, where, you know, there is no mortality, well, to a certain extent, there is no, you know, you don't have to necessarily eat or drink or breathe or any like we know it now. It's sort of like the game world, where when you're in the game world, you don't have to eat if you don't want to. You don't have to, you know, you're not breathing, you're not doing anything. As the line from, and I'm going off on a rant here a little bit, the line from that Morpheus said, where he said, you think that's air you're breathing now. And then once he realized it wasn't, he stopped breathing, you know, more or less. You know, they didn't really go into it too much, but that's what I think is outside of here is the unlimited version of this, because it's perfect. Inside here is perfect conflict. It's inescapable. We all run into it. Yes, 99%. I mean, yes, there's these, Dennis Leary said it the best, where he said there's these brief moments of happiness. You know, call it, you know, two minutes to eat a cookie or a 5-second orgasm or a drink or whatever it is, you know, that we have. But the rest of it, you know, we're just kind of slogging through this this reality, and I think it's very deliberate.
Yeah, I mean, sometimes when you hear these things, I always think that there's some nefarious power that should not be that's at the top of that chain that's controlling it all through media spin. But then you try and find that power that should not be, and you come to somebody that's credited as being some sort of puppet of some description. So, you know, it kind of, it's nice to extrapolate along those lines, but you said something quite interesting, which again brings me back to what Antonio describes as a heliocentric entanglement, which was macros within macros. So as soon as you said that, I picture how it literally sounds. So what we see at the microscopic level being very similar to what they present us in space on the macroscopic level. But could it be that we have this idea because of literally things like Men in Black, when they show the example you gave earlier, where you start off with a solar system, you get further and further away. I'm pretty sure they did it in Contact as well, a similar sort of thing. Yeah. But they show you getting ever and ever and ever bigger until you end up with something that we would consider absolutely tiny, which is kind of asinine.
Well, they have it also in 2001, A Space Odyssey. You have the obelisk, then the stars, then the baby, then this traveling through dimensions, which is what it's portraying. It's saying, which of these is real? Are all of these real simultaneously? Is none of them real? Is the one that you're sitting on in the cinema, is that the real one? There's different ways of interpreting the dimensionality. I like the idea that you have, in the Matrix, you have the Matrix, all the people, and him, and the phone, and all of that, and Agent Smith, and the physicality of him, once he's unplugged, is physical, is now real, okay? Everything was the avatar. It's an avatar of him, but, you know, he can learn, I now know Kung Fu, you know? All those sides of the things he can do inside the game, inside the simulation, but there's also the physical him. So I'm thinking, okay, if this is a simulation, is the equivalent to the physical Neo, is that what the religions call the soul or the spirit, or is there some point at which there is a physical us? What? Those are the questions, really, is it, aren't they? You know.
Yeah. Is there a more physical version than this? Depends how many layers you want to go through, or if you really want to, because, you know, we enjoy, I shouldn't say enjoy, we experience this in its entirety. You know, this is real. Peer's real. When we're out of this, I mean, yeah, we could probably have different versions of this, but I think eventually you're going to want to, I think this is the ever-expanding evolution of something deep at its core. There was something I thought about recently, which was, you know, it's kind of a thought I came up with, and I hadn't made a video on it, called, you know, if you had the chance to find God, really, should you even look? Because you may not. It's that line from Planet of the Apes, the very, very last line of Planet of the Apes, before Charlton Heston starts freaking out, where Dr. Zaius goes, you know, don't look too hard, you know, for whatever, you know, you may not like what you find. And what I mean is, some of the there's a line from I use a lot of movie references. Lawrence of Arabia, which was then used in that other movie, the Alien sequel, which is great things have small beginnings. And think of it this way. We'll use American football real quick. For example, American football right now, there's so many different aspects of it. You've got, not only do you have the players and the coaches and the cheerleaders, you also have the fans and the people that built the bleachers and the people that sell the hot dogs and all this huge amounts of variety and splendor that branched off from such a small thing. You've got people out there that are dedicated that are going to tell you, that can tell you every quarterback stats for the last 10 years, right? You know, they're really, really focused on this. But you ask that same person, who created the NFL? They're not going to be able to tell you, because it's so many layers deep. It's usually this small, and when you read the story, I'm not going to give it away. People can look it up for themselves. But when you look it up, it's like, it's just one guy who made like no money. All he did was write the rule book for it. That's all he did. He said, you know what? This is a game. Here's how it's going to be played. Here's the basic rule book for it. Go. And it just kept expanding and expanding and expanding and expanding. So if you're asking if there's a physicality at like the highest level, I don't know. I mean, maybe, but I don't know. Let's put it this way: when I finally die and go off to wherever the next place is or that's outside of here, and somebody asks me, it's like, hey, you know, you have the power to go search the universe and search for God. I don't know if I'd look. Because, you know, unless, you know, again, stealing from the Matrix, because going to the source seems so cliche, you know, that you're going there and you know, this big, you're bathed in white light and you become ethereal and you become part of the one consciousness. I don't know. I think I'd still want to explore more and more of these type of worlds. I still, by the way, think that we're here more or less voluntarily. The line that Bill Hicks used years ago before he died, about that this was a ride, you know, yeah. this was part amusement park ride, and that people that talked about it, people that tried to convince others that it was a ride, generally didn't last very long, because the system either automatically or people that were inside the system didn't want to hear it. I've said on several things where imagine if, like for a ride, for example, here's the difference between a normal ride and what this could possibly be. Anyone's ever been on a roller coaster? It doesn't matter where you are. If it's Disneyland or Disney World or wherever, you know, you go to on a roller coaster, it's kind of scary, but you know you're on a track. You've maybe been on the roller coaster a few times, every twist and turn, you know, it's like, yeah, it's kind of fun, but, you know, you're more worried about some guy throwing up next to you. Imagine if you woke up on that ride. Imagine if you... all of a sudden, you know, you were given temporary amnesia and you don't know how you got there. Kind of like the movie Memento, where you woke up and you had no idea what was going on. That ride takes on a whole different... Then that ride literally becomes life and death. Every turn, you think you're in peril. Everything that's happening, and Bill Hicks, that's what his big thing was. It's like, you got to remember, you're probably on a ride. You know, he was convinced of it, I know. I don't think it's just a ride. And I don't mean like a roller coaster ride. I mean like one of those stupid haunted house rides where, you know, it's super slow or you're on tracks and doors open and things pop out and scare you. But that's, you know, I think that's part of what we are. I think it's part ride, part planetarium, part terrarium, part school. You know, even though there's not a lot of people, I don't think it's completely entertainment though, by any stretch. Sorry, I go off on these tangents, but people, you know, I think it's really one of three things, and that is either entertainment, education, or confinement, or a combination of one of those three things. Well, it can't be solely entertainment, because most people aren't really having a lot of fun.
I'm lost. Are you saying that what we are experiencing is entertainment for a third party?
No,
but that's an interesting thought.
Like training, like... So if part of it was training, you know, like an academy for developing skills, yeah, or for achieving things, so yeah, there would be like the educational aspect, the entertainment aspect,
yeah,
you know, so for each individual, you know, person.
Yeah, yeah. Nothing's wasted here. I can tell that. I mean, yeah, there may be some education. In fact, South Park, I've still got to download that episode and show a clip out of my thing. I'll probably get copyrighted for it. Where they did an episode called, literally the episode was called Earth Canceled, which there was that Earth, even though it was a ball, was just this giant reality show for everybody else outside. And
yes,
we're, you
they,
know,
they want to make way for a highway or something, so they're just like, this show isn't doing very well, we've decided to put a freeway here anyway, so you're just going to get demolished.
that was from Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, that part of it. You're mixing, but that's okay. No, Hitchhiker's Guide did the same sort of thing, and that was we were just this stupid planet on the way of, you know, in the middle of the galaxy. But South Park treated it like a reality show, and finally the ratings were slipping enough that they wanted to blow it up, and of course the kids had to save it. But it was very enlightening, that little episode.
Do you
episode.
Remember how they saved the show? I think I remember this. They capture the two, they're portrayed as being Jewish aliens. And they end up in bed together, and they get a Polaroid of one of them sucking on the other one's shoulder, which is apparently its sexual organs. Yeah. So they just hold the Polaroid to them and like blackmail them into keeping the reality show that is Earth running with this.
I do salacious. Not know how they got away with that, because the portrayal of those two producers were so horrible.
It was just horrible. Yeah,
it was tough to watch. I was going, yikes! It's like, really, don't you have like producers that? And they're going, hey, for ratings, we'll do it anyway. And
that's what I thought you were going to say when you said, you know, when you go to the afterlife and you get the possibility of going and seeking God or the creator or the programmer. Would you? I thought you were going to say, what if I find him or her and they're in a compromising situation? You know? God, finish wiping, you know.
Yeah. Well, and the Matrix touched on that. You know, the Matrix, you know, they explained that the Matrix had a lot of levels that most people didn't, you know, most people were into the fighting and the special effects. But the Matrix really dug into that, where they were saying that all programs, when they're removed or leave, they have to go to the source. And if they don't, you know, then they're doing something wrong, and then, you know, all the different little aspects of how the whole the systems work. It really, you know, I know people really criticize the second and third installations of that series, but I really, really enjoyed, you know, even the architect breaking it down. I know his monologue was a little dry, but I thought it was interesting as hell.
I did too. I really enjoyed the architect.
Have either of you seen that? There's a YouTuber who's put it together, explaining how the Savior character is not Neo. Yeah. It's Agent Smith.
I think it's Screen Rant.
That had escaped me completely.
It's brilliant, and it's true. It's true. It's dead on. The Agent Smith and how they lied to Neo the entire time, that Neo was just basically a player in the game. But yeah, the true savior was Agent Smith. He was the one that was the key to the whole thing. And even at the
but
very end of
the movie, that's just a theory. That was it. It was film theorist.
Oh, it's good theory though. Yeah. Even if it wasn't deliberate, it was. When you watch it, I mean, I've watched that trilogy. I don't know, probably 20-30 times at least. And there was a lot of stuff, you know, Agent Smith, how he was destroyed and then reborn. They didn't say how he was reborn, and then he was the one that was going to bring down the system. He was the one that actually killed the Matrix. I mean, yeah, it was.
Well, there's
you know,
a giveaway.
You
know, the biggest giveaway is when he goes in to see the Oracle and calls her Mom.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
So question. Say this is a simulation. Do you think it would be possible for a character like a Mr. Smith to break the simulation so that everybody who's playing the game, unknowingly playing the game, just suddenly the game stops and suddenly they have no other reality to face but their actual true existence?
Maybe, because like any simulation, and we can only compare it with, I can only compare it with stuff that we have now, like a giant MMO, a massive multiplayer games that are out there. When people know, you know, you come in, you play, you know, you log in, you log out, you know, sometimes characters die, but eventually the MMO has to end. You know, again, stealing from the Matrix. Everything that has a beginning has an end. And that is, sooner or later, you either run, could there be a shortcut to where the whole thing just cracks open? Maybe. I mean, that's why I think, not to say that Flat Earth is the ultimate part of that, but in a way, you know, if the 100th monkey effect does apply to people and enough people realize that it's. Well, in fact, here, let me take another track here. Look what's happened in the last 3-4 weeks. What we've seen. Neil deGrasse Tyson comes out before he starts going off on BOB in this last week. He comes out in a physicist forum and says that it's a high degree of probability that we're actually living in a simulation. And which really surprised everybody else. No other physicist jumped on that with him, right? And then a few days later, Elon Musk, not that he should have an opinion on anything, the man is a freaking bridge troll. I mean, I don't know why they even allow him on camera. But he comes out and says the same thing. Oh, yeah, it's a high degree of probability. We're in a simulation. It doesn't even, I don't even think he even quoted Neil deGrasse Tyson. And then, for whatever reason, I think like a day after that, the Alex Jones show runs a story on it, where you know Alex Jones wasn't in. It was some of his the younger people that he has doing his things, but they were
talking. Like a news report, didn't they?
Yeah, they did a news report on it. I'm going, okay, why are people like this talking about it? And Neil deGrasse Tyson, why did he start talking about this? Because here's a guy that's been, you know, he's the face of science, the face of space, the face of NASA, pretty much. Runs a planetarium, and he's going to come on to a physicist panel saying, "Oh yeah, by the way, it's probably all fake anyway." Why would he say that?
This is a nice segue, Matt, because you said earlier about programming, and we were obviously referencing rendering and simulation. However, we have this other type of programming, which is very much a man-made type of programming, delivered to us by the nefarious monsters with shoulder sexual organs. You know, we very, in a real way, do have this, and that level of programming is what gives us all of the lies about where we live and what we experience, and perpetuates certain ideas, such as the idea that we're living in a simulation. So when you hear these things, and they've been pre-programmed into us with predictive programming, the Matrix, we've gone through the whole list of them, you know, I won't repeat them all, but doesn't that make you a little bit unnerved?
Somewhat, and again, going to steal from Cypher on this one, from Matrix, ignorance is bliss. Where let's use the Antonio's Dark City reference from 1998, I believe. Where and by the way, a little
Shell Beach.
Shell Beach, but the memories themselves. Oh, by the way, little side note, which was it's tied to it, is if you look up one of the trivia things about Dark City, because it was also shot, I think, down in New Zealand. All the sets were down there. They used, to save money, the first Matrix used some of the sets from Dark City. They bought the rights to use them. So most notably, the roof chasing scene where Trinity was running across the roof. That roof was straight out of Dark City.
Right. Oh, wow.
They didn't tear it apart. Yeah.
They do it all day. Hollywood do it all the time. I noticed Transformers had lifted something from a previous movie. Whole chase sequence with the cars.
Oh yeah. Yeah. Well, hell, I'll use one more for you that they didn't even tell people about for years, and nobody caught this. Tell you how to talk about how people miss stuff. People say, no, you can't miss stuff. The last scene of Blade Runner, where they initially shot, and you probably maybe read about this. Ridley Scott was the one that released the story. He finally fessed up to it. Where Stanley Kubrick did, okay, so Ridley Scott was looking for an ending to Blade Runner. And initially, they were just going to get in the elevator, and that was going to be the end of the movie, right? Instead, Sean Young and Harrison Ford, they get in a car, and they drive up to the mountains. You know, they're driving along this mountain road. Well, the producers didn't like the original ending, and so they said, you know, of the elevator thing, and so Ridley Scott calls up Stanley Kubrick, and he goes, look, I know you overshoot everything, and you throw away so much footage. He goes, I need an ending to my frickin' movie. And so he took some of the driving scenes from The Shining, driving up the intro scenes when they were driving up those mountain roads. He took those literally and put them straight into Blade Runner with almost no editing. You know, it's just a few cross-section scenes with two people in a car.
Maybe the bits that Stephen King would have actually liked, because apparently he absolutely detested that intro.
Yeah. Yeah, but anyway, sorry. Back to Dark City. The thing that intrigued me, as far as doesn't make me unnerved, no, because again, ignorance is bliss. In Dark City, the one of the really cool concepts they had was that memory was all they had refined the electrochemical parts of memory to where they could insert memories electrochemically. Don't think for a second that we're ignoring that. in our sectors, in our technology right now, we know full well, there's a little side story I could throw at you, where we know now that really, really strong memories are electrochemically identical to the actual event. So, which is why you hear about, you know, like war veterans, they hear helicopters and it's like, you know, start jumping into bushes and stuff because they get these weird flashbacks. It's not that they're having memories of flashbacks. In their mind, it's actually happening. They do hear helicopters.
Yeah, the body, all the synapses fire exactly the same as when they're actually going through the situation. So in terms of their experience, it is the same experience. It's not a similar experience. The same things are happening. The same alarm, the same quickening of the heart, everything.
The line that Morpheus used where he said that if you're talking what is real, it's just electrochemical signals to our brain. There was a sports metaphor that we used in the United States. It was all about follow through. There was a test that we did at university. It was done, it's really strange, but it fits, where they had three groups. One shot free throws in a gym with a basketball. Another group didn't do anything. And then a third group just thought about shooting free throws. That's all they did. They just sat in a fixed position and they thought about shooting free throws for about the same amount of time that the other people actually shot free throws. Now, the people that didn't do anything, of course, they didn't improve. And the people that shot free throws, they did improve. But the people that thought about it, they improved as well. Now, of course, because they didn't have the physical motions going with it, they didn't have it, but they actually improved just by thinking about it, which meant that it tied into, electrochemically, back to Dark City, where once you got the formula down where Kiefer Sutherland, you know, all you have to do is add this and this, you know, a touch of teenage angst, and you can basically create memories and insert them into people, which that part gets kind of spooky when you start thinking about it. You want to talk about something unnerving is that, you know, not to freak people out that maybe, you know, having some drugs and listening to this right now, but if whoever's listening to this, they may have only been in existence for the last 10 minutes because all the memories up until the time you turned on this show didn't happen yet. Until now.
All right, this is back to The Sixth Day, just to bring in a new movie. So you've got Arnold Schwarzenegger, who is essentially, God, I'm going to say this word, a clone. So he just wakes up in a taxi, and of course all of his memories are perfectly intact. He knows who his wife is, he finds his way home, no problem. But when he gets there, the real him is there, and he's been replicated unnecessarily. So he has to come to exactly that terms with the fact that he was literally only created 10 minutes ago, even though he doesn't realize it. As far as he's concerned, he's been in existence forever.
It you can get in some really, really weird. We're getting close to where we can do this with machines. Look at the Sean Young reference from Blade Runner, where she had this entire backstory, and it was one of the coolest moments in that movie, where Harrison Ford pulls off the creator, you know, the guy that built her, and he goes, "She doesn't know." And he goes, "No way. She's a robot. You know, you gave her all these memories and you never told her that, you know, you never gave her the thing." She actually believes that, you know, everything, that her backstory was completely legitimate. And so it's really fascinating for me, looking at it. Is it unnerving? No, because I mean, who knows how many things that have happened to us that we've got memory blocks in place already. Something that I had always toyed with when it came to this place right here is that it would have to be, I shouldn't say have to be, but there's a certain possibility that it's voluntary. And you're saying, well, what do you mean voluntary? I mean, like, you signed on a line, you know, you paid like a ride, you know, you gave the guy your ticket, you had every chance in the world not to get on that ride. You know, it's not like they forced you.
Perfect segue into one of my favorite shows, which is Red Dwarf. So there's a show in Red Dwarf, I think the episode was called Despair Squid. Now, the plot of just to keep it brief, they're in an attack. They're in their ship, but they're in an underwater planet, and they get attacked by this squid who covers them in ink and kills them. But then they wake up to the words "game over." They step out of these four pods and realize that they're not the people that they thought they were.
I remember that episode. Yeah, and they were all horrible versions of themselves. And they were
Dwayne with buck teeth instead of being the cat who's all well trimmed and looks really cool. He's got these big buck teeth and an anorak covered in piss, you know, and stinks. He's a tramp.
Yeah, Yeah, and they all wanted to kill themselves because they were just in this horrible, horrible place. Yeah, the despair score. Wow, I didn't remember the title of that one.
But they have two levels to this simulation. So essentially, they all wake up in this group hallucination, which is what I've just described, which is the simulation of Red Dwarf. So Red Dwarf is a game that they've all been playing for several years. But the computer Holly, another different type of simulation, manages to get through to them on one of these wavelengths that they can all hear to tell them that they're having a group hallucination because of the despair squid, which has literally given them group hallucinations. So layers upon layers, as always.
That's really so interesting you remember that, because that's one of the few Red... I mean, I like the series too, but it was one of the few Red Dwarf episodes that actually stuck with me, because it made you think. It had that whole layer to it. Oh, by the way, I know somebody will probably correct in comments if I don't mention this. I had forgotten that, remember that 13th Floor was based on Life on a Wire, which was from 1973, but that was based on the original one, I think it was a 1960s book, if I'm not mistaken, not maybe late 50s, called Simulcron, terrible name, Simulcron 3. Which basically, of course, like everything, they starts as a book, though, but where they were talking about simulation within a simulation, where the ultimate plot twist, as you're building the simulation, you realize as you're building it, hey, wait a minute, you know, kind of like, let me tie it all the way back to the Apollo missions. One of the reasons why, and I know people say it's your worst clue ever, the part that there's no movies made about the moon. And I say, no, you can't let Hollywood make a movie about the moon, because as they're making it, things will start clicking. You know, you don't want to give people too many clues. You know, so as a Hollywood producer, as they're making it, it's like, okay, we're gonna make this thing about the moon. As they're making it, going, hey, wait a minute, this thing, what we're making here, this looks just like the real thing. Hey, you know, and then all of a sudden it starts happening. Kind of like the guys...
You're going to hate me now, Mark, because I'm going to do what I do to Antonio and completely contradict you, which is to say that a lot of the levels of predictive programming that we get are about space. Now, I know they're not specifically moon landing movies, but they are about space. And to bring this back to simulation theory, so is a lot of the science fiction about simulation theory. So you kind of have to think, well, we've been lied to by the quote-unquote programming that has been given us by men, and now we have all of this new programming, not about space, but, well, it's a nice, easy get-out for the globe lie, wouldn't you agree? Simulation theory? It was all
It is. I don't know if you caught one of the strange worlds I did recently. I read a statement, I think it was by the ethereal science researcher, which said that he was part of a group that they had done kind of like a fake simulation thing on some guys, where they put some people in a room and they had them sit in chairs with some kind of headpieces with wires. It all looked real, you know, kind of like the punked thing you guys did with space cadets over there in England, where you convinced those guys they were astronauts. But sure, you convinced these people they were in a simulation. So all of a sudden you flickered the lights a whole bunch of times and you said, all right, and then you made sure the lights were slightly different in the room. And then you had them, you know, open their eyes, and when the room lit up, it's like, okay, you're now in the simulation. And there were people that bought it, because why wouldn't they? You know, they were walking around, they're going, you know, touch things and figure out where you are, and you notice there's other people in the room. And at first, you know, people were, you know, they weren't buying it, but after a while, they were starting to get
it. It's the power of suggestion. I mean, you touched on this earlier when you talked about, I think you used a basketball example, but this is actually a very real principle that they do use in sports. So a nice example that I can give, because I've literally seen it happen, was with the bobsleds. So they will literally visualize the way the course runs and run through in their mind, and they'll physically do it like I'm moving now, but with their eyes closed, visualizing the course so that they can perform better when they go down it. So it these are sort of natural things that won't necessarily be manipulated, but can be taken advantage of just by the way we wire our cognition. So it's basically making neural connections that aren't necessarily there prior to you doing something. So in terms of the basketball example, they're not throwing the ball, but they are making the neural connections before they actually pick up the ball and throw it.
Yeah. I used to be a carer, and one of the people I looked after had a brain injury, which was the equivalent to, I won't give any details because it wouldn't be fair, but it was the equivalent to a botched lobotomy, if you imagine that, okay? A severe direct brain injury where he lost all ability to move. But it left his memory intact, and he remembered moving, and he could hear, and he was told, get used to this, this is the rest of your life. He didn't believe this, okay? And he remembered walking, he remembered feeling things, he remembered being able to do things, and he used to just play because he couldn't physically do anything when nobody was communicating with him, which they would, you know, from time to time people would communicate with him. He would play with his memories. He would remember, he would replay memories, and he would remember those memories, the areas of the body that engaged with those memories, and basically he shifted, his brain didn't heal in terms of, you know, where you have actual damage and you have separation in the brain, okay? He should have been dead, you know, by all rights, you know, that usually that kind of injury leads to death. He didn't die. But instead of creating dendroids or synapses, swinging back to reconnect with connectors that were previously part of the makeup, he shifted, his brain shifted the ability to move and feel and sense. The locality where those things are accessed naturally in the brain were shifted to a part of the brain that was intact and basically accommodated there. And I would take him out, you know, on socialization. He was really nice guy, you know, spoke fine, totally fine. You would not know what had happened to him. And I would say part of his therapy was going for big walks, long walks, so that he could basically walk, you know, not just stay around the house kind of thing. So what you're saying in terms of your cognitive processing and the ability that creates, it also has a physicality. It can create a physical part, component, that accommodates the illusion. So you've got the illusion of actually walking, you know, and you're completely disabled. And that, by engaging with that over and over and over, you can actually mesh, create something that accommodates that to the point where you can actually engage with the world in the way you've been imagining. So, and this has happened before. It has happened several times with people. There's a famous person, I forget his name now, Richard Hall wrote a book about him, the comedian, American comedian, about a guy who was inspecting open cast mining and a rod. So they drill into the ground, they put a rod and they put dynamite at the bottom, and somebody fired this and it shot right through his cheekbone, right through his brain, but he's still alive. You know, the guy continued to be alive and writing to his wife and whatnot, you know? So where sometimes the world presents something that's absolutely 100%, this, the end result of this is definitely 100% X. And along comes somebody that demonstrates that that's not actually true. You know, this is also available, you know? So we have the programming that you're saying, Nathan, saying, oh, look, it's simulation theory. That's the scapegoat. As long as they can say, look, as long as we rendered a good enough impression that we went to the moon, that's all that was necessary. Now, you know, maybe it's flat. Nah, doesn't matter. Later, it might be a cube. We might change it at some other point. As long as they can do that and have enough stopgap explanations, that's fine. So that could be.
Well, I'm going to bring you on because we've talked nicely of simulation theory. So this is a retelling of an age-old story which we've gone through on about half a dozen or more movies, probably a dozen movies. But it's a retelling of the skeptical argument. Maybe that's something you can summarize quickly now so we can go through the negative sides of why possibly it isn't a simulation.
Yeah, the skeptical argument is basically a philosophical thought experiment. That the Matrix is the foundation of the Matrix. You know, for all we know, we might be just dreams that are being had by a brain that's, you know, just kept alive in a vat, or by a genie. A genie might be having a dream that has all these different characters, which are, one of which is me sitting here with this, and Mark and Nathan and all the people listening, the whole world, all of which could be just the imagination of one mind. That's a skeptical argument, which is used to basically, it's their get out clause, which is, you can't say for sure that fire burns, because for all you know, you're in a dream. and that fire isn't real, and your burn is also not real, and you aren't real, and neither am I. So that's a foundation for the skeptical argument. It's called the skeptical argument in philosophy. Then it's just basically it's that. It's a way of saying, well, you can't say for sure, because we could all just be dreams. And there's an element to the simulation theory which is also that, which says you can't be sure, because we might just be playing a game where everything seems real, but it's just a game being played by us. That's it.
Well, in that game, Mark, we have something that I know we've spoken about at least once before, which was NPCs or non-player characters. Could you give us a bit of an idea what that means, first and foremost, in the game context?
NPCs, I don't know whether I should call them positive or negative, because they absolutely are necessary. As games became more and more advanced, they realized that people needed to get things done and meet with people that could, you know, kind of like characters in a story that were always there. You meet somebody at a bar and he gives you a note and the note says something. Well, you know, that person, that's a really boring character to play if you're going to be actually in the game. Nobody wants to be that guy sitting in the bar. So NPCs were created, non-player characters, as placeholders instead of routine clues that were running, you know, things that were on the ground or things up on a wall or something like that. People actually walked around.
They play, if I'm not mistaken, they play signposts. That's basically the role they play in a game.
Pretty much, but they're disguised as average everyday citizens that walk around a city. And as the games got more and more advanced, they realized it's like, you know what, let's just outfit the city with a full working population, more or less. You know, people that are, you know, the person that works in the laundromat, that takes your ticket and gives you your shirt back, you know, that's been there for 40 years, you know, that person, and you might be able to engage in conversation with them. That person doesn't have to be a player. It's most likely going to be an NPC. And as the games got bigger and bigger, they realized that the support staff, the NPCs, really, and if it became kind of a catch-all. So it's like whenever you ran into something, it's like, let's put an NPC there. Let's put an NPC. Let's put some NPCs everywhere, to the point where in some places you are outnumbered 10 to 1. You, depending on where you go, if it's a small area of the map, you're outnumbered by NPCs by a lot, which kind of begs the question, if you were building something like this, you know, a world where we are, it was supposedly 7 billion plus people, how many NPCs, you know, how many people are real and how many are NPCs? Do you need, I mean, if every, take, we'll just take an average game like, well, not average, but one of their higher profile games like Warcraft, if every city you walk around in is 85% to 90% NPCs, then what does that say about where we are now? You know, and who's real and who's not? Because if the programming's good enough, and really it comes down to creative programming, and I don't want to sound blasphemous by saying that God is a programmer, but you know, beforehand, you know, we describe God's building construction techniques on the tools that are available to us. So before there were power tools, God used hand tools. They were divine hand tools, but they were still hand tools. And now we're getting to the point where you know, God's absolutely coding. He's coded a lot of stuff because it just seems like that's what we are. And if you code something well enough, you know, we still haven't gotten any, as far as I know, of course the military probably has it. What was the name? The Turing test, where you take a computer, you know, and you put them behind a wall where you can't see, or it's a computer, you give them a speech modulation system, and you put someone on the other side, and the Turing test is you ask them a series of questions, and at that point, can you tell if it's a person or a computer? Once we get to that point where that is undistinguishable, well, there's your ultimate NPCs right there, because then you can engage in somebody in a conversation, and yeah, responses are going to be ultimately limited, but depending on how clever you are with the speech systems, you know, you just get to the point where... Go ahead.
I might ask you about, I think he's called Watson. Now, this is something I read about a good couple of years ago and have kept a vague interest in ever since, but it's now being very heavily advertised. Do you know what it's about, this IBM software?
Is it like a companion type of thing, kind of like the version of...
Essentially, the way it works, I've probably got the name wrong now, but it basically will cross-reference billions of different questions. So you could... The example I saw a couple of years ago was... Let me get this right.
You're right. It's a question answering machine by IBM. Supercomputer. Combines artificial intelligence and sophisticated analytical software named after IBM's founder. I did not know that, Thomas J. Watson.
Yeah, so you can ask this thing a question, and it will extrapolate the answer based on all of the internet searches you could do based on that question, and boil it down to what would be the best positive answer and what would be the best negative answer, or best pro answer and best con answer. So you could get it to fight either argument. It's the best spin doctor in the world.
Well, look at that movie, and I didn't really like it that much because I thought it hit way too close to home with Joaquin Phoenix and her. The movie was
Scarlett Johansson.
Scarlett Johansson as the computer voice. That movie creeped me out but it was upsetting because I said, you know, after I'm watching this, I'm going, look, that's where we're headed. You know, that's where if we get to our software, remember, this wasn't a robot walking around. This is just somebody you're talking to. You know, this is very, very doable. And once you got to that point, I hate to say this, but there's a lot of, you know, I don't want to pick on guys too much, but there are guys out there be like, yeah, you know what, that'd be totally my girlfriend. I could live with that.
Well, so it's not so controversial with something a bit sexual. I've just remembered the Watson example that I heard a couple of years ago, and it was about diagnosis. So you have a patient that comes into a hospital, and they have a rare disease, and you ask Watson, what's the best form of treatment, and it will analyze all of the previous treatments and the stats for the person and give you a probability, and the chances are Watson might say that even though there's a procedure that's been done 400 times with a 90% probability of success, in this instance this particular patient has got a much better chance of recovering from their illness with this way out, only ever used once procedure that nobody's, you know, thoroughly checked. And that was the example they gave. In other words, it could boil down the probabilities much, much better than any human could ever do because it's looking at so many different angles all at once.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, and then you're getting into the argument of true artificial intelligence. And I'm sorry, the powers that be are way too smart to, you know, is it possible that if you write enough code and you give the program enough options to build its own, to start building its own things, will it become self-aware? At that point,
you know, you reference from the Skynet of Terminator.
Well, not just Skynet. There were movies before Skynet that talked about this. Where, in fact, there was a late 70s movie, if I'm not mistaken, where the computer was basically making choices and having people assassinated, and saying, "Look, that leader. There's a high such probability that leader will not be compatible to the ultimate goal." Once the computer figured out that it could run the world. Again, how many references? I'll give you the one that most people remember, that is Tron, the master control program from the original Tron, which was, you could tell by the end of the movie, even though it was a Disney movie, it started to take a dark turn where the MC program was getting into military and politics because he said, I could run the world something like 1,400 times better than you can run it now. And once a computer figures out,
rip off the profile, takes over in South Park. They make it akin to Facebook, but his Facebook profile takes over.
Yeah.
What was it called? The Lawnmower Man. Do you remember that film? So the Lawnmower Man is a guy who has very low intellect, and thanks to somebody who's very capable, he advances his intellect to the point where being human isn't good enough, and he realizes he can figure out how to transport his energy consciousness element of his existence into the framework of electrical circuits in the whole world to do with all communications, and says, you'll know when I've done it, when all phones, I will ring all the phones, and then all the phones start ringing. So it's kind of like that, but backwards. Instead of it being a human uploading his consciousness, there could be a case that it goes the other way around. A very sophisticated software program is developed to the point where, when bringing it back to the sex thing, where you've got very sophisticated, perfect human clone type robots that have no human tissue, everything is totally artificial, like Blade Runner, with that level of consciousness. So if you add what I forget the name with Joaquin Phoenix and Scarlett Johansson, but that film. Do you remember the film?
Yeah, it was called Her, H-E-R.
Her, yes, of course.
Yes.
So if it ever gets to the point where that's the level of sophistication, of this consciousness, this artificial intelligence which becomes conscious, and then this artificial intelligence has the access to a robot with a database that can be through Wi-Fi continuously accessing and updating its software, basically. Yeah. Then we arrive at Battlestar Galactica, which is the realization that humans were basically this kind of pesky thing that tried to switch everything off when they realized that they created something that was superior to them. And, you know, there's the battle and there's Battlestar Galactica.
Good reference. I had forgotten about Battlestar Galactica, that the whole thing, everyone knew it was us against the Cylons, but people forget that it was a big thing about artificial intelligence. Mm. Look at, and by the way, Lawnmower Man, and then look at the movie that ripped off Lawnmower Man at the end was Lucy.
Yes.
Lucy took drugs, became super, super smart. What did she do at the very end? She uploaded herself into the network. And I actually, until you had mentioned that, I had forgotten. I was like, why does it seem so familiar? And now I know. It was an 80s movie with what's-his-face that's no longer acting.
Yeah, I forget.
I know I've done this once already, but I've got to bring it back to this subject. So we've got all of these references to simulation theory right the way back. And they run parallel with all of the references to space. Now, I think we'll all concur on this panel that we think that our representation of space is totally askew. Would we all agree just before we go further?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
So with all of these ideas that are given to us through, you know, rags like The New Scientist and through our media manipulation, doesn't it kind of make sense that this is just going to be another structure used against us to deceive?
Well, if I can jump in here, there's also an extra element in the conspiracy world. There's a guy called Edward Meyer, or Billy Meyer, a UFO guy in Switzerland. He has a following which is headed by a guy called Michael Horn. Now, what the story is, you have these beings that are traveling to the Earth from the Pleiades. And they're explaining various different things. They have a capability to travel around in space. They can say what's going to happen in the future. Strangely, he's made certain predictions that are, you know, that have come to be correct and published them physically, not just online, but he's published physical books with these predictions, and later they've come out. Okay, so this Michael Horn is explaining that one of the problems that the Pleiadians are saying to the humans, which is something to be alarmed about, which links into Bill Gates and the whole Agenda 21, is that there are too many humans being born for the number of souls available for them, or for the number of characters able to play them, the number of consciousnesses able to play characters. So it goes back to what you were saying about the non-player characters. They're saying there's a hell of a lot of humans being born that don't have a soul. And that's an organic way of expressing exactly the same. There's a lot of non-player characters being rendered. It's the same thing, but from the conspiracy world, because now simulation theory, which started, I think Nathan wants to take it to the cons. So we've looked at the pros, at the elements that are kind of cool and interesting, and let's look at the cons, and I can see by his smile that he's like, yeah. Some of the cons are that it went from not really considered conspiracy, the simulation hypothesis. So it wasn't a theory, it was classed as hypothesis, because a theory requires facts. And to link the double slit experiment, the fact that when they look in microscopes, it gets to the point where matter turns out to be ghost matter, that it spontaneously stops existing and other matter replaces it of a different shape, the quarks, all these elements. It's a tenuous link from that to say that these things are representative of the rendering not having been done at that layer of inspection. You know, you can inspect to this point, but from that point there's no point rendering, because it's not necessary. At a deeper point, you would literally see zeros and ones, or the fiber of the actual matrix, the mesh. One of the elements that's negative about the simulation hypothesis is the the removal of the humanity towards each other. Like, if you go back to Bill Hicks saying, guys, it's just a ride, and people come back who remember that it's just a ride, and they say, hey, don't worry, because it's just a ride. And people hear this and kill them. They say, shut him up. This has got to be real. Look at my big bank account. Look at, you know, look at my family. And so how Bill Hicks was expressing it, he was saying there's an element of fear to the game, the dream, or the reality, the life. Let's call it all varieties, let's call them just life. You know, it could be a game called life, it could be a dream called life. There's an element of fear. And he was explaining, look, the element of fear that we have is something that's injected in continuously through propaganda, through media, through all kinds of things. So in fact, everything that's aimed at the public has elements of fear, because fear sells. And he was saying, if you detach yourself from if you remove yourself from the avenue where fear programming can access you, your consciousness, then you live a life without fear. And that's what the guy saying, shut him up, don't want, because they profit from the fear. So the hypothesis that the simulation theory is saying is, in one hand, it's saying, don't worry, because it's just a game. But on the other hand, it's saying to a lot of religious people, and I'm not a religious person, and a lot of non-religious people, it's saying, all that you're doing could be completely useless because it's just a game. And that itself is a much more profound level of fear, which is the opposite of what Bill Hicks was saying. It's like, dude, forget what layer of fear, forget what type of fear, what quality. It's fear itself that you need to realize. It's just an illusion, because we're all here only temporarily. And the get-out clause, you know, the final rescue is death or game over.
This is what makes me think that it's exactly that, and it's just another control structure to create. You know, you've got elements of sex in there, and you've got elements of death in there. And the element of death is akin to the globe lie. You could be wiped out at any minute by a massive asteroid. We could switch off the computer, and you'd all just disappear. It's the same thing to me.
There was something, because you really touched on something important there, Antonio. There is a downside to this, and that is, if people know about where they are, would there be an abuse of power? And I've got several examples to give. One would be, because, you know, I worked in the video game field for a number of years, and I started out doing support for games, and so I got a lot of phone calls about games. And you know, one of the first questions was, of course, you know, how to install, you know, how to get the damn thing to play. But the second most popular question I ever got was, what are the cheat codes? Because, and if anyone doesn't know what a cheat code is, it's special phrases you can type into a prompt inside the game which give you special abilities, abilities you would never had, God mode, basically. Make yourself immortal, give yourself a whole bunch of lives, make yourself super deadly. And this happened, and I had a friend, and he and I kind of used to joke philosophically about this, and these phone calls just bugged the hell out of me, because these kids would ask for the cheat codes on the first day they'd get the game. That's how impatient they were, normally guys. And I said, and every time I got this call, I'd look at him and I'd go, this is why there are no cheat codes to the world, because if they got them, they would use them. And if you think I'm kidding, there was this interesting little story that came out back in, you know, when The Matrix came out in 1999, that the guys that, and I don't, you know, you got to speculate on exactly who was involved, was the government or somebody else, but the guys that did the Columbine shooting, and I was in Colorado when that happened, the big Columbine shooting, and I had no doubt that it was real. I mean, people, you know, the kids falling out of second-story windows covered in blood, you couldn't pay a kid enough money to jump, you know, head first out of a window like that, anyway, but the point was, is there was a story that came along separately, and I do believe it, where the rumor was that these kids, because The Matrix came out that summer, or, you know, came out that year, that these kids not only watched the movie, but they were told by somebody, you know, somebody brought them aside and said, oh yeah, it's totally real. It's absolutely The Matrix, to see what these guys would do. you know, that these kids would see what they would react. If you told somebody, you know, somebody young and impressionable and had access to weapons, you know, oh yeah, by the way, it's a game. What are you going to do about it? You know, what would your next plan be? And to the point where, if I'm not mistaken, someone will have to look up the old story on it, to where the Vatican, where the Pope actually, when he had heard something along these lines, they actually screened the Matrix to see what it was about. Because remember, back in 99, that was a brand new concept. I mean, yeah, I know the 13th floor was the 13th floor of World on a Wire, but the Matrix really put it in a different different frame, to where, hey, you know, what if you could go out and just have a whole bunch of problems?
That's sorry to interrupt, Mark. You do realize it's totally ripped off from Ghost in a Shell, right?
What, the Matrix?
Yeah. Yep.
Well, yeah, but that was animated. So.
Yeah. Nah, fair enough.
Well, you know what I mean.
Being movie pedantic, I'm really sorry.
No. I like Ghost in the Shell. Ghost in the Shell was really, really cool, and you got a point. But again, Japanese animation, I mean, not. There's a lot of people that don't watch it. So, Matrix was super, super mainstream. But I'll give you one more example, and that is in the gaming world now. They have areas. I'll use the Warcraft example. I'm sorry. WoW for those people that play, which is. There, in a lot of cities, in a lot of the major cities, there are no police. And there's the reason why there's no police is because they don't allow people of the same faction to fight amongst themselves. So if you're in your home city, say you're on the blue team, you're in your home city, you are not allowed, you and I are on the same team, I'm not allowed to walk up and punch you in the face and start a fight or hit you with a sword or anything. And you're thinking, yeah, so what? Well, the reason is because if they allowed that, that's all anyone would ever do. The cities would become a freaking riot zone. And people would just be coming up because they've seen this in previous games. We've learned from our mistakes in that arena.
You
where
see in real life, I've been to paintball.
The what?
You ever been to paintball? You ever done
paintball happens the same thing. Yeah, people will, you know, it doesn't, for whatever reason, there's a lot of people out there, NPCs or not, that just, they don't care. They don't care who they fight or who they, you know, who they want to stir it up with. They're just going to stir it up. And so what they did was in WoW was they removed the police entirely from home cities. Now in other cities, there's police everywhere. And there's still people that tempt the cops. You know, they still try to do stuff because, again, they know it's a game. They know the consequences aren't real. Now, if you made it a hardcore game, right? Here's the difference, and there are hardcore games out there. If you made it to where if you got taken down by the police, if a policeman, you know, hit you with a sword, your character was dead for all time, and you had to start over from scratch, you bet they wouldn't, you know, then you treat it much, much more carefully, which is kind of like what we're in now. If all of a sudden, if you released, we're going back to the down aspect here, if you told people, a whole bunch of people, that it wasn't real, there would be a group out there that would say, and now you could say what you want. It's like, oh yeah, there's consequences and there's penalties and there's a scorecard and you can get real trouble outside of here. There's a lot of people that wouldn't care. They'd be like, you know what? I'm going for broke. Get me to a gun store. And they're, you know, they're just going to go off on a jag and start wasting people on a regular basis. We've seen this in various movies, you know, when people, you know, finally, you know, when they snap. So yeah, for me, that's the biggest fear is the reaction of what even on a even if it's, the way
what I think
the impressionable people you talked about earlier, the people who are really impressionable, the people you put in that room, you dim the lights, you tell them they're in a simulation and they go, yeah, I am. Well, they're the impressionable people. He actually dressed like Neo. He had the full leather jacket, you know, he was dressed like Neo. He full-on thought he was Neo.
Yeah.
But I think one of the most insidious or nefarious qualities of this simulation theory is that in warfare, so whenever your nation goes to war against another nation, the propaganda gears up where the people in that other nation are not quite people. They're not quite human, you know? They're sand monkeys in the Middle East.
Yeah.
There's this dehumanizing aspect. And that's when one nation goes to war against another nation. And it seems to me like the simulation theory is a perfect way of using the same divide and conquer, because it turns out that both nations, they are human beings, being told that the other nation aren't really human beings. They're lower, you know, there's something wrong with them. But behind that are the same bankers that are paying for the propaganda so that the war will happen, so that they will make lots of money. So it's a really good way of having that same you're not quite human with your neighbor, within your own nation. All these people, all of them, non-player characters. And there's no way of proving or demonstrating by in the game, a non-player character cannot demonstrate to you that he's a non-player character. It can only be your discernment. And it can't prove to you. It can't prove to you that it isn't. And you can't prove to it. So there could be a non-player character out there whose job it is to declare that other people are non-player characters.
Nice.
They could say, I think this person is a non-player character. And, you know, says to Mark, for instance, Mark, I think you're a non-player character. And Mark's now in the position where he can say, no, I am. I am a player character.
Yeah.
I'm willing to bet he gets it every day.
Yeah, and it's the same thing. It's the same thing as the terms, you know, the kraut. In Britain, we have kraut. All Germans, that's it, all of them, kraut, in the Second World War. And in Germany, it's just this element of division, and a division that's really profound. You still have people that hate nations that we've not had any wars with for a long time, you know, but there's still this animosity because it's so ingrained. You know, from the grandparents hated, my grandfather hated the French because he'd been in a French concentration camp. So, and he was patrolled, the way it was guarded by French military. So he just, Now, I've known French people, really nice, you know, but it's just this divisive quality that it's brought, not just between nations, but now inside nations. In fact, inside families. Because it's built on the skeptical argument, there really isn't a way of proving anything, of demonstrating anything. If you're accused of being a non-player character, there's absolutely no way that you can prove that you are, because the person accusing you can say that's exactly what the non-player character would say.
It reminds me of the last 5 minutes of Vanilla Sky. With Tom Cruise, where Kurt Russell, his psychiatrist, is on top of the building, and the tech support guy is going, he's not real. And Kurt Russell's going, I'm real. I am real. But then he stops because limited responses. There's only so much he can say. And what you were saying about prove it, again, another movie reference, let's use Matthew McConaughey in Contact when he was talking to Jodie Foster, and he asks a really good question. He goes about proving something, and he goes, did you love your father? And she goes, yes. And he goes, prove it. You know, prove, you know, how do you define love? And then you go back to the Matrix where they said love is just a word, blah, blah, blah. But, yeah, interesting. Let me, there was one more thing that reminded me, which was, if people, you think that the average person, you know, the impressionable person would turn ugly, potentially, if you told them it was a virtual reality, right? Imagine a division of troops that were out in the field, and all of a sudden they figured that out. Different from, like, if they found it was an enclosed world. If it was an enclosed world, you kind of figure that you're all in the same boat. You probably won't be shooting each other. It's like, drop your guns and walk away. But if all of a sudden it's like, oh, yeah, you're in a virtual reality, it doesn't matter anymore, and you've got these guys who have access to a whole bunch of stuff, I can't even imagine the potential chaos. Because the animosity between, like, officers and enlisted men. You thought Vietnam was bad. Oh, it could get super interesting. You know, entire camps just erupting in flames, you know, right off the bat. I just thought of that just now.
I have a cousin who was in Afghanistan after 9/11.
Yeah.
And he was explaining the camp were British, predominantly British and American. That was their camp, basically. And later other nations came around. And he was explaining the differences between each, you know, how the Americans had all kinds of stuff. And the Brits, they have to sign for everything and they have to pay. This is something that's not well known. They have to pay for their flak jackets. They have to pay for the rounds that they shoot. but they have to pay for things. When they wear their boots out and they need another pair, they need to pay for them, you know? Huh. So, yeah. So they also have to account for every round that they shoot. So they go out with a magazine and they count their, you know, if they lose count of how many shots they've shot, they have to count how many bullets they fired to log down, because the Brits are like, dude, we don't want you firing just randomly. So there's all kinds of stuff, the differences between the different armies, you know. Yeah. But there was the friendships and the animosities between the armies, and these are armies that are on the same side, you know. So the Americans had all these cool things, and the Brits had all these other cool things, but nowhere near as many. So there was this bartering happening, you know. It was just really interesting, but it was the animosities between them that was the most telling. Like the Americans, all of them, vaccinations, or just all of them lined up. And the Brits, half of them, they just walk past the line where the Brits, some of the Brits, yeah, they just go, and that's it. They've skipped the whole vaccination thing.
Nice. Sorry, I'm gonna change the subject. Sorry, Antonio, to cut you off, but I've got to bring back on topic. So,
Well, it was all a simulation anyway. That was the end.
It was not a simulation. The bullets didn't work real. So, I mean, one thing I've noticed in modern technology, and I know you're very interested in this as a gamer, obviously, Mark, is the way that technology is being spun towards a very literal simulation. I know we've got VR. It's pretty much, I would say it's like here, pretty much, although it's expensive. You can go out and buy VR headsets and plug them up to PCs, and you are then immersed in the Matrix in a very literal sense, plugged in. And again, I don't want to put words in your mouth in terms of negative spin, which I'm going to try and do no matter what, so I'll just stop there and hope you'll run with that.
Oh, you mean where VR is going and the negative side of where it could go? Oh, well, it's
well, that's what, well, I don't want to. I said the negative side. That if I carried on, I'd immediately say.
Well, no. It's okay, because look, let's be realistic here. The everyone knows what's driving this technology at this point and has been for years. It's sex, and sex is what's going to keep driving it. The very first VR, the very first hologram, the very first immersive, because look at Surrogate, the movie that Antonio was talking about, 2009 with Bruce Willis. That's what it really was. It started off with where you jumped into the idealized version of yourself, the handsome, chiseled, you know big-breasted, long.
I've got to drop this in here because it's a priceless moment, because there's a very rich son of a rich, the inventor of the surrogates, his son at the beginning of the movie goes out and finds another person in a club. Now obviously they're both in their surrogates or in their avatars. He finds this beautiful blonde, she gets killed, and then the police go back to find out who's playing the beautiful blonde character, and it's this disgusting slob of a man, this fat obese guy. And it kind of reminded me of back in the days of AOL Instant Messenger, when people would set up their fake profiles and you couldn't send pictures, and the guys are there pretending to be beautiful blondes, and of course they're not. It's just exactly the same.
I was an AOL forum consultant back in the day. So, yeah, AOL, when it was the only American online, for those who are too young to remember, when it was the only game in town, when it hit about midnight, AOL became a very dark place where anything could happen. And, yeah, I mean, that's what drove the membership in AOL, was those forums and all those rooms that could be created late at night. And that was really, really basic chat technology. The movies that, like Surrogate, you know, where they're showing what's happening, you know, where it's all based on sex. Oh heck, let's go back to Brainstorm. That movie with Christopher Walken. You remember that movie? Oh, I got you on this one. Look up the movie Brainstorm with Christopher Walken back in the day, where he was a scientist that figured out how to record the human thought into a cinema-like thing. So you'd be riding on a horse, riding through a pasture, and you'd hook up to this machine. It would record the entire event and play it back. You could have somebody play it back. And of course, what was one of the first industries to jump on it when he invented it was? It's like, oh yeah, let's do some sex stuff. That's where it's all going. That's what's driven. I mean, that's what drove cinema. That's what drove cameras.
Another Red Dwarf reference. So Red Dwarf, a very early episode, had total immersion video games And they were the latest craze when they left Earth. Obviously, they're 3 million years in the future. So they've waited a very long time to get their mail. When they've turned around, they've eventually caught up with their mail. And they get this interactive game. And, of course, they all go to their nicest places, find lovers and get married. But the problem is the hologram character suddenly starts fantasizing all the bad things. And the next thing you know, all of the characters are neck deep in sand, covered in jam, about to be eaten by ants.
Yeah. It's definitely a drawback to, I mean, on one hand, I mean, look, we, especially in the United States, I can't speak for other countries, the technology is driven by money, and the money usually comes from, you know, the seedy side, the baser instincts. And that's what we've been chasing for a while now. They, you know, all the major corporations, whether or not they say it, they're never going to do a press release on it. Oh yeah, we're researching virtual sex. Nobody's going to want to run that story because, you know, even though the story would pique some interest, there are a lot of people that have stock in those companies aren't going to want that to happen. But that's what they're all gunning for. They all want, I guarantee, the very first the first virtual reality thing will be some floaty, you know, ethereal thing, but that's just what you show the press. And, you know, the thing that you buy in the back room, the thing they're really going to be selling a million of, you know, or a billion of, that's going to be the dirty stuff. So,
you know what I'm
thinking?
The
porn will be what Apple buys.
Oh, what did he say, Nathan?
The what?
I just said the porn will be what sells. It's sex. It's always death and sex.
Yeah.
So, have either of you guys seen The Onion, when they did an article on, I think it was Second Life?
Oh, right, Second Life. I completely forgot about that until just now.
So have you seen The Onion? You know Onion, the mock news? Always. So they're explaining that there's an update to Second Life where you can play a character and you can make your avatar look just like you if you want, and you're playing a character who's playing a character on Second Life. And it says, look, when I move my hand here, this character who on the screen is sat in front of a screen, he moves his hand there too. So this rendering of a game, which is rendering a game itself, This is like, if this was a simulation, if this really was a simulation, then all the further simulations that go on, you know, total immersive, you know, sense bod, you know, so scuba suits with all sensors, you know, brain, the whole virtual reality, that would be exactly the equivalent to a game rendering a game rendering a game, you know. And it could get to the point where, you've surrogates, but instead of walking around being all heroic and cool, you're a surrogate whose game it is to program games, you know. And nice. The endless regress situation.
We haven't touched on this yet, but I was going to bring it up at some stage. I was going to bring it up towards the end of the show, but it's just a nice segue into it, which is the game Sims. I'm sure you've probably both played game as well.
So
Sims is, again, quite a terrifying notion when you explore the idea of simulation theory, because we could very literally be those Sims.
Well, have you seen the advertisements? You know, the little still shots. It's like, create your perfect family. You know, and there's a husband and wife and a couple kids and a dog and a kitchen. I'm just going, but I mean, they're treating it, they're advertising it like, you know, like this could be your escape. This is your life. By the way, Antonio, Second Life, I completely forgot. I knew friends, people that had played it, but I never really got into it because, you know, like, look, if I was going to get into porn, I'd just get into porn. Yeah. You know, Sims is just an excuse to have a mixed video games with porn. It's not like a 3D render, but yeah, there's a lot of people that play that game and they use it as an outlet, like a social context. It's like, you know, you meet up with people and you're kind of chatting and there's hot images going around you and that's kind of exciting. But yeah, that's the darker side to video games, which you don't see news people really running with. They'll run stories on all the squeaky clean stuff. Like AOL was very squeaky clean. It was considered family friendly, which it was until it got, you know, past midnight and you fed them like gremlins. And then it turned.
Well, this is something that I really wanted to discuss. And I didn't get discussed on this show, but I'm glad it has. Which is that the impression the media gave of AOL was, especially with Instant Messenger, was that it was completely unlike email. It wasn't tracked. It didn't. There was no record of the instant message. You sent a message to somebody, and then it was gone. And then you had things like To Catch a Predator, demonstrating that they very much were being monitored and tracked, and people were being locked up. the horrible things that they did. But now in modern times we have the onion router, the Tor network, which is sold to us in a very similar vein. It's, you know, it's completely secure, and every time I ask an expert, they tell me just how secure it is. And it just reminds me of what we were kind of spun with AOL. You know, it's anonymous, no one can know who you are. And then, you know, later in life that you find out, I'm sure you know now, how easy it is to track somebody who's got an IP address.
Yeah, very, very easy. By the way, I want a quick side note on that movie, that old movie, Brainstorm. Yes, I'm old when I say things like this. 1983. One of the darker sides to that was, again, it kind of had a stupid ending, but kind of. But it also delved in, yeah, sex was the first thing they delved into, but was the second group that got involved was the government. Because they said, oh my God, we can use this for interrogation on a level that we've never been able to do before. And so then they used it to where, you know, you could basically give somebody a psychotic break, you know, without even having to lift a finger. You just put the headset on them, hit that sucker, and they're going to confess and do whatever. And then the movie finally delved into something that was even weirder at the end, and that was one of the researchers that was working on it had a heart attack in the lab and put the headset on and recorded her own death. And, you know, and then people were literally, you know, falling over each other to try to figure out, okay, what did it record when you died? And they had to figure out, you know, you had to disconnect, you know, all the cardiovascular stuff, because basically if you played it back, you were going to get a heart attack just like she did. But that, you know, it delved into the whole going down the tunnel of light, and it was kind of cool. I might want to rip that and try to put it into one of my things if I get a chance. I completely forgot about that movie.
Hey.
But it had a cool little ending.
Yeah. I was sunbathing just before I went to uni. Okay, I'm sunbathing with some friends. We've got the radio playing music, you know, we're just chatting. It goes on to the news. The news, you know, plays out the news. And at the end, they announce this new development. And then the DJs pick up the last item on the news, which was this technological development, and start explaining it, talking about it back and forth. It was a chip that had been created to be implanted on the optic nerve by a group called BT Technologies. I've looked for this group, can't find a thing, can't find anything. This chip goes on the optic nerve, records all the visuals, and because your brain thinks in visuals, it records all your thoughts.
Yeah.
And they were talking about this could be a step for the cloning. So this could record all your thoughts, then this could go on the decoder, which would play your thoughts after you pass away to other people, or to yourself, if you get cloned, you know, they just put this, you know, flash drive, download into the thing, put it into the new human version of you. Just completely crazy stuff. But when when we think in terms of the technology that they have, the things they have, and the things they announce that they have, and when the announcement come out, and it's announced once, even in a newspaper article, it's freaking mind-blowing, the stuff that they announced. That they announced here in the UK in one of the broadsheets on Sunday. They explained...
Sorry, before you get on to that, Antony, that was something we touched on earlier on the sixth day. So we were predictively programmed with this idea by Arnold Schwarzenegger when they put a couple of cups over his eye, flash him, and then they've taken essentially that, a flash drive of his memory, so that it can make a clone. So this idea has been given to us quite some time ago.
Yes.
Well, Look at the more recent one, Johnny Depp, 2014 Transcendence,
yes,
where a dying scientist decides he's going to record everything he is into a machine and then becomes artificial intelligence, blah blah blah. But yeah.
So are these the powers that be, laying down the groundwork for the discussions by Neil deGrasse Tyson and these people for humans to endorse, basically accept this, which, yeah, could be valid.
Maybe.
Very difficult to disprove, that's for sure.
Yeah.
But could be just, it could be a big distraction. It could be basically saying, hey guys, where Bill Hicks was saying, look at fear as a, you know, you're a temporary thing on this plane, and then you move on. Don't spend your time living in fear. And he's using the analogy of the amusement ride. This could be the same thing where they're saying, look, guys, this is just a virtual reality. It doesn't matter that you have to pay your taxes. It doesn't matter that you have to drink fluoride. Don't worry about it. It's just a simulation. and remove us from something that could be basically very, very different to what we're being told is a simulation. If it turns out this is not a simulation, this is a training ground for the soul, and it's a physical, real, true, organic thing which can be represented by the observer. So, you know, with the double slit experiment. So one of the things that they looked at was, is what's causing the waveform to become a particle the fact that there's an observer, where the observer's act of observing engages with some mechanisms that molds the wave into a particle, that collapses the particle. Is this something that's going on? The simulation theory can accommodate this. In hindsight, they didn't say, do it, you know, predicting ahead and saying, ah, this could happen. But it's in hindsight that it could be this. So when we look at things in hindsight and we say, ah, it's this, it's exactly the same as when people say it's the work of the Archangel Gabriel, you know, or pretty much the same thing. But if we boil it down to we're organic beings and our actions and the repercussions of our actions can be much more significant than we can understand right now, that we're here voluntarily, like you said. So we chose to be here. We were given the option. It's not, this isn't a life sentence, you know, there. You've done bad in the afterlife at some point. You've done something bad, and now you get punished by having to be a human, you know. It's a different situation going on. If we get distracted into considering things that are basically a distraction, that don't actually mold our life in terms of the benefit that we derive from it, other than, well, the only impact that it can actually have is to alienate, to separate us from the actual enjoyment of life, where your neighbors are not non-player characters, they are human beings, and all the other characters are player characters, they're all human beings. I think that's the best way. This is Pascal's wager, you know, I'm going to bet that there is a creator. So I think that one way of looking at this is, okay, if it's a simulation, let's assume that everybody else is also playing the same simulation, because we've already arrived at the conclusion there's no way of demonstrating that somebody is a non-player character or that we ourselves are not non-player characters. There's no way. There's no way to determine that. So we might as well assume that it isn't a simulation and look at what things we can do. Because if we look at the simulation, and it turns out that the double slit experiment was trying to show us something to do with the nature of the energetic forces that we're part of. We know that at a fundamental level, we're a combination of energies, and if we can't expand it along that avenue because we're looking at simulation and technology and how things can be modulated to give impressions of things rather than actually mold things, then we've lost a big thing in life. We've lost an opportunity.
Maybe, I know you've both mentioned it on several occasions now. On one of the mechanics of the fourth wall, we talked about the observer effect experiment, and you've tied this now to the to the double slit experiment. Can one of you give a nice explanation to what that is? I know it's complicated, but I think it's worthy of at least a bit more of an explanation.
The double slit experiment. Right. Okay.
Yes. Yes.
Double slit experiment says, I don't want to butcher this because there's going to be guys out there, you know, nerds especially. It's going to go, no, you totally missed stuff.
Matter. I'm handing it over to you.
Matter is either they've said that matter is either a particle or a wave. And they say it can be both. We'll get into the Schroeder's cat thing. Nah. Okay. So what
determined? Why not
the Schroeder's cat thing? When you look, you have a box. I don't like the dead cat argument though, and that is, we'll just say there's an apple in a room. Otherwise, you're killing a cat. That'd be mean. So let's say there's an apple in the room, but the door is shut. Simultaneously, the apple is there and not there. Meaning, until you open the door, how do you know it's really there? It's the tree falling in the forest argument. If the tree falls in the forest and it no one's there to hear it, does it make a sound? No, because you're not there to hear it. meaning you're the only one, you're the only one to determine if something's actually exists because you're the only one watching it. So what they determined was in this experiment, they were firing protons through these slits. And while they were watching it, and while they're firing them through these slits, they produces a certain a scatter pattern on the back wall. If you're watching it, it's kind of weird. It's like a sci-fi movie when you hear the experiment, because if you're watching it, it acts exactly like you predict. But if you turn your back and you're not watching it, it acts different. It acts like a wave, like the particles. The protons aren't going through the slits like they should be. So it's like, okay, you set up a camera, so you don't have to watch it, right? You don't have to watch it live. And when the camera's on it, technically that counts as an observer. So it's like, I hate to say this, but it's like there's a sentient power that knows whether you're watching it or not. You can't just say that the protons are sentient, because that sounds silly, right? Well, so does flat Earth. But something is manipulating the protons to react to you observing it. And what I mean is it doesn't make sense from a logical standpoint. Physicists should absolutely just freak out, because it's the closest thing to magic or God that you could ever think of, and that is the protons are being manipulated based on your focus on them. If you're watching them, they act a certain way. If you're not watching them, it doesn't care. It's going to do the lazy thing. It's going to, again, which really leads to what we do in programming now, which is if you're not in an area, if you play any sort of video games and you're flying over an area, you look behind you real fast sometimes, or if you look in front of you real fast, the trees that you were just watching disappear and fade away. Why? Because it's conservation of resources. I'm not saying that God is lazy. I am saying that God is very, very efficient. So God is not going to waste any energy on things that are there. It's a cheat. It's not necessarily a cheat. It's very efficient in the video game world. You don't have to build the entire world. You don't have to build parts of the world that you're not in. If you're in there's a city that's 100 miles away, you don't have to build that whole city if no one's in it, because who cares? You know, it's the argument. So that applies to us here, which is, you know, we do this in the video game world. And it appears that it's happening here as well, and which is why the double slit experiment, in my opinion, is the closest thing we have to evidence of a simulated reality, which is if you're not looking at something, if you're not paying attention to something, it acts, it's not coalescing, it's not materializing, but every time you look, it does, and it just drives me insane, because the only proof that we had was that double slit experiment, because it kept firing off the thing. It's like, well, every time you don't look at it, it acts like it's not even there, that the protons are just acting completely different, or they're acting lazy, like they're not being specific, like they're saving resources. And yeah, that's...
Like they have a default setting. Yeah. The default setting is relaxed. If something engages with it, then your default engaged with setting is particle. When nobody is engaging with you, then you go to your basic default setting. So there's like two defaults. And it doesn't matter if you're sat there focusing, trying to make it into a particle. No. If you're looking at all, particle. If you're not looking, wave.
We do move on, maybe again, Antonio, I know we did it on the other show, but because it's much easier to summarize and people have a better visualization of what you're talking about. Can you just explain the experiment for the observer effect and hopefully keep it to just a couple of minutes, because then people can tie exactly what you've described in quite a wordy way to something that's much more visual.
The observer effect was, it came from the double slit experiment. Because they started to look at what's causing the collapse into the photon. What's doing this? In what way is human consciousness and observation causing a difference between the default setting of wave and the particle setting? What is this? And because in the UK we have a lot of engineering, weapons industry is the biggest export in the UK, so very specific engineering is crucial in lots of things around the world. So there are people that have an impact, have an effect on machinery that, you know, in sailing, there are jinxes. There are people that you don't want to sail with because always something happens when that person is on a ship. And it's the same, I'm sure, Mark, that you've experienced the same thing. There will be people that you've worked with on whom computers crash. Like, it's like that guy's computer has crashed 12 times and that guy has worked on different computers and the computers crash. I know a guy on whom this happens continuously. His computer is continuously...
My wife, Paula. Paula has this happen to her. So yes. Paula, when she has interactions with electronics, they break.
Yes. So the observer experiments that were set up were an engineering university. What they did was they set up a whole series of experiments, scattered them around the university, and didn't announce that these experiments were there. They were created by the engineering department, so they were perfectly calibrated, and there were a variety of them. There were pegs on a board and ball bearings that would fall when the door shut. There would be a room, a glass panel, and these beads, you know, these ball bearings. And the door would just simply have a note saying, enter. That's it. You know, and students absentmindedly would just walk past and enter. You know, either they took a wrong turn or whatever. So they'd enter, the door would close, and these pins would fall. And they ran the thing with nobody watching, and then looked at where the pins had fallen, and they were always kind of randomly chaotic. And when people were looking, they were falling in an order. They would fall towards the center, making this kind of pattern, or towards the outsides. So they had the pins, they had a column of water, a jet of water that was spraying at the constant pressure all the time, and it looked like a column of glass. But when somebody went in and looked, now these are students who've walked into a room, they're thinking, oh, what the heck is this? They see something and they're like, huh? It's being recorded. And the column of water, as they're looking, thinking, what the heck is this? The column of water starts behaving, starts leaning one way or spurting higher. There were a variety. So this was created for the psychology departments and the neurology departments to try, and physics, to try to determine what qualities are there in human consciousness that can create glitches in machinery, in hardware. What is it about humans and consciousness that can cause this? They haven't arrived at the conclusion. The Noetics Institute is still studying it. And when we're talking about the double slit experiment, Mark, where I think the story goes along the lines of the device they were using to shoot the particles was took a while to warm up. The guys that are shooting the particles go for lunch, and instead of switching it off and going for lunch and then having to wait whilst it warms up, they leave it running. They go back, So they go for lunch, come back, and it's been displaying a different arrangement because there was nobody there watching. This... The effect that came from the consciousness and the observer to the particles, the Noetics Institute, the HeartMath Institute, various universities have determined that this effect has a feedback, and the feedback happens before. So you have people saying, okay, you're going to, the wired up, you're going to look at a series of images, and you're going to press a button to say pleasant or not pleasant. And the image is going to be a lump of mud, a puppy, a cup of coffee, a hot chocolate, cake, a decaying tree, maggots, just all kinds of stuff. And what they think, because they're aware that the observer effect and expectation and consciousness molds the results, they just have to press a button when it's a pleasant image, okay?
Yeah.
So maggots, they don't press a button. Hot chocolate. Button, okay, but what they're actually monitoring is the response in the brain, which is registering unpleasant image just before the maggots are shown, pleasant image just before the hot chocolate is shown. So this observer effect, whatever mechanism is engaged, has a feedback. It works the other way. It works preemptively. So this has led to the concept of superluminosity, which is a tool for conceptualizing the future, looking, gazing at the future. If you think, for instance, now, Mark, if you say, okay, in 5 million years' time, the Earth will, and whatever it is that you thought it right now, but time, 500 million years, in terms of speed, would have taken way longer than how long it's taken you to say, in 500 million years' time, X. Yeah. Yeah? So this is a new concept, superluminosity. It's in philosophy, in psychology, it's a new concept. But there are echoes of it in history. Echoes of it, for instance, with the double slit experiment, with the observer effect, with all these experiments that some people might call kind of into the paranormal, you know, they're kind of described a little bit like that in some of the more mocking fields. So this is something that's true. Now, this is what causes me to doubt the idea of the simulation theory, which is, if it was a theory, we'd be able to predict certain elements that would be discovered. And it seems to be more like a religion which looks back and gives reasons for things in hindsight. So it makes me think, you know, it looks to me like what we live in is something organic. It feels like a kind of the wrong, something spiritual, let's say.
Sure.
It's something something real, truly real, not a rendering. Something really, truly real that has surprises, that has elements of magic, not from the Asimov or, you know, Clark explanation that at some point in the future technology will be so advanced as to be indistinguishable from magic, which is a term coined by either Asimov or Arthur C. Clarke.
Yeah.
That itself, the term, sometime in the future technology will be so advanced as to be indistinguishable from magic, okay? What the concept, that concept says, technology, we know what technology is, will be very sophisticated. But there's a second term, which is magic. It's saying there is technology, and it functions in a way that at some point would be indistinguishable from the thing that we now call magic, which at some point we might call something else once we get a deeper understanding. Like sure. With telepathy, you have telepathy and then you have psychometry. You have psychometry, which is different. It's picking up on micro signals, on all kinds of things that aren't actually telepathy. It gets kind of convoluted when you go into this world, into thinking.
Well, they are saying exactly this, Antonio. So the new scientists are saying that if you extrapolate, like I said at the top of the show, if you extrapolate out Moore's law, you end up with us, by virtue of mathematics, being... it's mathematically impossible that we're not living in a simulation. In other words, you know, it's a mathematical certainty. And I've said this time before that they've recently said the same thing about aliens. They become a mathematical certainty in the heliocentric model.
Yes. And but the thing with the mathematical certainty, so this is important. There's a guy called Flat Earth Maths.
Yes.
And what he's doing is he's showing how there are elements to mathematics which, when you look closely, are false and not true. So what he's doing is he's using AutoCAD and describing circles, describing shapes, and then looking at the longhand way of doing it. With the longhand, you have a true square, for instance, of certain proportions. With AutoCAD, when you try to do the same thing, you have discrepancies where corners don't quite meet, you know. And that's because AutoCAD is using the type of mathematics that can render false results. So, which is like Bob in Globebusters. Bob had this example of it's a false result where three guys go to a hotel, they all pay X amount, then the transfer of money back, and it turns out they've all paid less than what they should have done. A dollar has somehow disappeared in the transaction. In the true mathematical sense, no, everything is squared. But with there's a way of expressing mathematics which will render false results. We should know this from looking at Einstein and what he did with basic relativity, which is express that it's impossible to describe everything because you'd need an infinity of time to express all the different elements, but we can start to express the rudimentary elements if you reduce everything to zero and start from zero at the Big Bang. But that is a con. That's a straightforward con, because it's saying, okay, if zero, then all these things. You say, okay, what if not zero? If not zero, then all of these things are just your invention, basically, because zero isn't possible, you know? And it's just a sleight of hand that he did. So with mathematical conclusions, mathematically certain that we're in a simulation theory, mathematically certain that there are other habitable planets out there in space, all these things, mathematically certain, it's like, no, that's just bullshit. That's, you're using maths to render a result, which is bullshit. And the same with John Nash, with his working out a theory to demonstrate that all humans will backstab all other humans. You know,
governing dynamics.
Yeah. It's like, dude, you set something up to give the result that you've looked for because you're a paranoid schizophrenic. If the guy was a saint, he would have looked at how altruistic humans are, would have set up an experiment that would have proven that all humans have altruistic qualities to them. It's just in your bent of mind, you know. And with simulation theory, there would be people out there who believe simulation theory and have a really great life and do some really great things. And then there will be the Columbine shooters who will look at simulation theory and do really messed up things. You can't blame it on the belief with the theory. It's basically the intent of the human being. And this is why I say I think it's better to bet that there are repercussions to what you do than to bet that there aren't.
Maybe we've gone too far the other way now. I can see Mark slumping in his chair. Maybe we've gone too far towards the negativity that it's definitely not a simulation. Mark, maybe you can. We're coming up on 2 hours. Maybe you can round out the show with something a bit more positive.
No. It could be a simulation, but it's one of those. I mean, if I was the authority and I wanted to, wanted to create a massive distraction. Again, remember what I said when it came down to, because people have asked me, okay, the flat Earth thing, everyone's kind of getting a hold of this thing. What could be the setup? What could flat Earth be the setup for? And I think it could only be one of three things. One would be the the giant spaceship, showing up, the golden spaceship landing somewhere, and in London, and coming out and saying, sign a few pictures, autographs, that whole thing. The other one would be some sort of staged Nibiru event. God help us if they try to drag that old pony back into this thing. It should have been, that thing was, I was all over that in 2012. That's 4 years ago. And the third thing, though, the last thing would be some sort of simulated reality, con, not con, whatever you want to say. It's probably the most dangerous of the three because the flat Earth enclosed world puts us all in the same boat. And I really do think soldiers would put down their guns and kind of walk away because everyone would be like, okay, what do we do now? Nibiru would cause a whole bunch of chaos, at least for a while. You could turn that into a high drama. It's like, is there something, anyone can save us from Nibiru, and then you bring in the golden spaceship again, and that starts over. But the virtual reality, that's a rough one, because again, there would be people out there, a lot of people, men particularly, real screwed up men, who would use it to their advantage and say, you know what, I got nothing to lose. Maybe they've led bad lives. Maybe they're just angry. I mean, think about, I'll not to downplay the ending of this, but I mean, think about all the disgruntled office workers. I mean, we have office shootings now, right? And things are pretty real, apparently. Imagine if it became unreal. How many white collar people would walk up? It's like, I'm gonna go home, get an assault rifle. I'm gonna shoot up this place, and multiply that by a lot of people. So it's definitely the most dangerous, in my opinion, but I think it might be their fail-safe. You could try to convince people that was going to happen. I mean, but I don't think – I try to go after the glass half full. I'm still going to say that they're going to try to turn this into if you want a new world order, yeah, you might have to wipe out a whole bunch of people, but it'd be better if you could not. So I'm hoping that they can turn it into something. I still think there's a chance for a golden age. I do. And I don't want to do... I know people like their conspiracies dark and brooding, like their Batman movies. But, with Heath Ledger, that's what you want to go with. You don't want to go all George Clooney, shiny and blue. But I do think there's a chance here to turn it into something good. So virtual reality, it's possible. Do I think, you know, I think it's another layer to this. Do I think we're going to be exposed to us right away? No, I don't think so. Because that's really the game over type thing. There's too many people. I mean, people can, you know, you've seen what was happening to people's heads with flat earth and closed world. And, you know, people, it's blowing their minds. I mean, I'm getting messages all day long. People are just freaking out just about that. I mean, I'm getting people that are crying, people that are screaming and yelling. If you told them that it wasn't real, it changes. I don't think it's, I think it's too much that they can digest in one sitting. So
there's also a possibility. So we've got the world of science and physics, and we have the world of religion, which talks about more ineffable things, you know, the spirit, the soul, where is it, what is it, all that kind of thing. It could be a way of trying to blend the two, because it's impossible to think of the simulation theory without thinking of the characters that are playing. So what are those characters? Those characters are consciousnesses. Where are those characters? And it's a way, it sounds to me like a way of saying, look, religion, you know, think in terms of longer life than just this. This is just a game. And I love the idea that this could just be a really, really cool, sophisticated dream. And when you finish, then you wake up somewhere else and you're like, ah, damn it, it was a dream. I could have done all kinds of stuff, you know?
But we've got one more reference in there. We've got Vanilla Sky now.
Yeah.
Well, let me... Oh, shoot. I forgot what I was going to say. It was... Damn it. Keep talking.
Good. So if I say that religion, science, bringing science to the point where it blends with religion to express that human consciousness is an element that's not actually rooted here. It's rooted elsewhere. And the here is just a mechanism for it to engage with things, to learn about things, to fuck up, excuse my French, you know, to fall off the cliff, you know, to crash the car, to meet your perfect partner, to do, you know, to look at the flower, to whatever it is that you want to do. Yeah. It sounds to me like a perfect way for the world of science to move science and give a scientific explanation for the existence that we're living, that links to a creator, a thing that did the programming.
Sure.
You know?
Sure.
You know, there's that side to it.
Yeah, I do believe that we're here to experience, to get a fresh look at our perspective, which is, and I don't want to quote too many things here, but we all know them, which is you can't fully appreciate something without knowing the opposite. You know, light without shadow, pain without pleasure, and so on and so on. You know, I do believe that we're here. There was an old Mayan saying which really confused me at first when I first heard it, which was one of their little things was stay alive as long as possible. And I was going, oh, that's really odd. It wasn't like, you know, live a good life and be nice to people and pay it forward and all that other stuff. It was stay alive as long as possible. And I'm wondering if they meant that because the longer you stay, I just hate to say this because it sounds kind of masochistic, and that is the longer you suffer here, the more you will appreciate it when you're outside of here. That some people go hardcore and go all out, and some people don't go hardcore. Some people, you know, come in and like they're auditing a class. It's like, yeah, I'll do a little suffering, but you know what? I'm going to be a millionaire. By the way, one more thing. I just remembered that what it was. You were saying that you could never prove that somebody was an NPC. I just thought of this. Actually, you might be able to, and it's a movie reference. Sean Penn in 21 Grams. Probably wondering what that movie was about. It was kind of a connection movie where he ran over somebody in their car and he got attached to somebody who was in the hospital and their relation to him, they were kind of tied to it. But where's the title come in? And that was, if I'm not mistaken, it was the Germans did an experiment where when somebody died, a person, not animals, when somebody died, they became 21 grams lighter.
Yeah.
And of course, you know, the Germans being screwed up, tried to, even though I'm German, tried to capture that essence. It's like, it's the soul, we must grab it. And you're thinking, okay, but then it comes into like how to prove somebody's a witch, you know, if they float or if they drown thing. It's like, if they die and they don't lose any weight, well, then they were an NPC. Yeah, but you had to kill them to do it. Yeah, but it worked. So you could actually find that out. I wonder if any person, if you actually, no, I'm not, I shouldn't recommend that on camera. Sorry. if they didn't lose weight, they're actually an NPC at that point.
Yeah, there are some really crazy experiments in the world of medicine. So, and sometimes that, you know, if you have an in with people, you know, psychology departments or very different elements at university studies. So they did it some time ago, and they pay for this. Okay, so and some of it's absolutely necessary. For instance, to develop the skills and the tools and the training for microsurgery. One of the experiments they were doing, one of the training elements that they were developing, was you would volunteer, you would receive, I think it was £80,000, and the whole thing was they would detach your thumb and then reattach it. So the surgery was the reattaching it. It might not work, you know, so this disclaimer.
Well, they got the nerve endings right, yeah.
Yeah, okay. You might end up with a numb thumb the rest of your life that will really bug you, you know, but who knows? But they were also doing experiments into flatlining. So flatlining, let's see what happens. What happens in the brain? How long does the activity go on for? Can we bring them all back? What tales do they tell?
Yeah.
I'm wondering whether at some point, somewhere, there are experiments going on when people are at the end. And
I don't doubt.
Yeah, to find out that, the percentage of people die and don't lose any weight. You know, there's no weight lost. So, yeah, that would be interesting.
Yeah, that was an early 90s movie as well. They turned it into a movie called Flatliners with Kiefer Sutherland, Julia Roberts. But that turned into like a dark thing where it's like you were too close to the afterlife, so you brought spirits back with you, and they were doing horrible things. And
this is going to make an absolutely excellent drinking game if you watch this episode of Mechanics of the Fourth Wall back every time there's a movie.
you'll be passed out in the first hour. We just face first. Yeah, yes. We used a lot of, but it's true. I mean, doesn't that say something? The amount of media that has been tied to this, that so much programming. Again, you know, why, if you believe in predictive programming, why would you spend the better part of 60 years doing science fiction references just on alien contact? The virtual reality thing has been peppered along the way, but think of all, we've got multiple generations now. Of alien contact, to where if an alien craft showed up today, I hate to say this, but everybody from age 80 to age 6 would get it. They would totally get the reference. So if, you know, all of a sudden they showed up on CNN and be like, oh yeah, I've heard about this. You know, depending how old you are, you may have watched 200 movies on the subject.
This is one of the things that I see some people shy away from the flat Earth because they're really entrenched in their thinking of aliens being from other planets, so, you know, space, distance, and so on. Yeah. I lean towards the molten puddle, possibly other molten puddles. So, you know, the distance not being that great that they come across in, and maybe they travel in the water, you know, above, if there's water, or not, who knows. But I kind of lean towards that, and that's, well, it's based on things that aren't really appropriate to voice right now. But
it's a whole different show. I'm gonna wrap up there, guys. So maybe right. You can give us some final thoughts. Mark, thank you very much for being here. Was there any last little points you wanted to drop in before we round out? Maybe give a plug to MarkSargent.com and so on and so forth.
How's it going, Mark? How's your
good. We have limited payment options, and we've been having a few payment issues here and there. Just trying, you know, on mobile devices because there's some blocking. But overall, the reception's been great. So cool. I'm excited about it. And it's just MarkSargent.com, and I'm doing plugs for it in different videos. So it is what it is. It's done by the same guys that did my apps, and I'm optimistic.
Cool.
Excellent. More power to you. I hope it goes well.
Thanks.
So, yeah, Mark Sargent from your spaceship above Stonehenge, England. Thank you very much for joining us on Mechanics of the Fourth Wall.
Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you very much for having me.
It's an absolute pleasure. And Antonio, thank you very much also. And to all of you who have joined us in the chat, thank you very much for being here. I've been Nathan Oakley. I'll see you all in the next video.